So welcome to NEET Crash Course, all of you. So now we will be discussing the synopsis of two chapters, in which the first one is biotechnology and its applications. So where exactly does biotechnology find its applications? It basically finds its applications in exploiting the living processes, exploiting the physiological mechanism of microorganisms, mostly to benefit us, like for example, to supply the best enzyme or best catalyst in the form of an organism which is expressing the best of its characteristics and something which we can develop for the benefit of mankind. To create optimal conditions for genetic engineering for the catalyst to act, it is not just about having an enzyme with you, say for example an enzyme expressed by a bacterial cell or a yeast cell. You also have to create, or you also have to provide, certain optimal conditions for that enzyme to work on a suitable substrate, provide a suitable substrate so that you get the end product which is desirable by you. In this case, the end product mentioned is a protein. Once you get the end product, you are basically going to purify the protein and then you are going to use it. Say for example, if the protein is a hormone, you can use it as a supplement, you can use it in people who are suffering from hormonal deficiencies, and basically the purification includes downstream processing. So in agriculture, it usually is used in the production of genetically modified organisms, improvement of crops, production of tolerance in case of plants, and disease resistant crop varieties, like for example heat tolerance and salinity tolerance, etc. Enhanced efficiency of mineral usage by plants. The plant should be capable of absorbing minerals and using them to the maximum extent in the soil. Also developing crops, also in reinforcing, or you can say enhancing, the nutritional quality, increasing the nutritional value, like for example vitamin A content is increased in a rice variety called golden rice. This is referred to as biofortification, as all of you are available. And by doing all this, by introducing certain qualities in the plant, you can usually reduce the usage of synthetic pesticides and fertilizers, and also you can reduce the post-harvest losses. You can make the plant more hardy and you can also obtain a greater yield. Now, such organisms whose gene or whose genetic makeup has been modified, they are called genetically modified organisms. You have heard about the most famous BT cotton, where BT stands for Bacillus thuringiensis, which is the source of the BT toxin, which is genetically incorporated into this plant. And this variety, which carries the gene for BT toxin, is resistant to insect, and as a result it becomes a genetically modified biopesticide or an insecticide that the plant itself produces to get rid of the insect pest. Then it produces a toxin that is referred, so you have introduced the BT gene within this plant, so it produces a toxin that is called the BT endotoxin. And you have to remember that it acts against lepidopterans, against coleopterans or beetles, and against dipterans like flies and mosquitoes. This toxin, how doesn't this toxin kill the bacteria itself that produces it? Because remember, the toxin is produced in its inactive form, that is called the protoxin form. And when this toxin is ingested by the insect and reaches the gut of the insect, only then is it converted into its active form. Otherwise, when it is produced by the bacteria, it is still in its inactive form called protoxin, and therefore it doesn't harm the bacteria itself. And then once the toxin has been activated inside the insect gut, it usually binds to the surface of the midgut and it causes formation of pores in the midgut, which leads to cell swelling and lysis in the insect. And there are specific genes of toxins which are basically present in the bacteria. There are genes like Cry1AC and Cry2AB, which are specific against cotton bollworms, and there are genes which is Cry1AB, which produces a protoxin which is specific against the corn borer. So you need to remember the gene and the toxin that is specific against a particular group of insects. Then we also have the antisense or RNA interference technology, which is employed in plants such as tobacco, like in order to get rid of these nematodes, which are called myeloidogyne incognita, and it is this particular It is TA alone, not TIA. So Meloidigyne incognita is basically a nematode parasite which causes a disease in the tobacco plant called the root knot disease. And using genetic engineering, you are creating a transgenic tobacco plant which is expressing a gene from this particular nematode. And so when the nematode infects the gene, it is ingested, it is ingesting the complementary double-stranded RNA that is produced in the host tobacco plant, which silences specific RNA within the nematode, and as a result the nematode is killed. So this is what is referred to as the antisense technology that is employed in RNA interference in case of pest resistant plants such as tobacco, which is resistant to the root knot disease caused by Meloidigyne incognita. So here, like I said, the complementary double-stranded RNA is obtained from the infected virus with RNA, viruses with RNA as their genetic material. So basically, you introduce this double-stranded RNA producing gene within the tobacco plant, either by using RNA viral vectors like you can see here, or you can use them as transposons which can introduce this particular gene construct within the tobacco plant. And then the nematode specific, always remember, the gene that you are introducing into the tobacco plant can also be through Agrobacterium vectors. It should produce double-stranded RNA to silence mRNA, which are routinely expressed within the nematode and which are very, very critical for the survival of the nematode. Okay. Applications of biotechnology in medicine. So you have insulin, genetically engineered insulin, human genome project, DNA fingerprinting, treating of genetic disorders by gene therapy and diagnosis at several genetic levels. Insulin can be produced. Actually, insulin is normally produced in the beta cells of islets of Langerhans, as all of you are very clear with it, and deficiency of insulin results in a condition that is called diabetes mellitus. Earlier, insulin was extracted from the pancreas of animals like horse, goat and sheep, but then later, because of allergic reactions, it was not used, and now we have the genetically engineered insulin. And it was later in 1983, Eli Lilly, an American company, that produced insulin from E. coli cells actually. And this human insulin produced by E. coli cells was referred to as the Humulin, and it is obtained by two methods. Either you use the pro-insulin gene in this case. So you take the pro-insulin gene, and this pro-insulin gene actually codes for an insulin which has an extra chain in it, which is called the C chain. So you obtain the cDNA of pro-insulin from the human cells and you insert it onto a suitable plasmid DNA adjacent to the lacset gene, which codes for beta-galactosidase, and then you incorporate this plasmid which contains the pro-insulin gene spliced along with the lacset gene into a suitable host, which is E. coli in this case. And then you can see that the transformed cells will express pro-insulin, but it will be a fusion protein which is pro-insulin along with beta-galactosidase, because you have inserted the pro-insulin gene alongside the beta-galactosidase encoding gene, which is the lacset gene. And then you remove or you destroy the link between the fusion protein by using the cyanogen bromide. You separate the pro-insulin from the beta-galactosidase, and then you can remove the C chain. From the proinsulin, you only need A and B chain, so you can remove the C chain by using proteolytic enzymes. So like you can see how the proinsulin is converted to insulin here. The actual functional insulin, the active principle, is only the A chain and the B chain. And by using certain proteolytic enzymes, after obtaining the proinsulin gene product or the protein from the E. coli, you are destroying the C-peptide by using proteolytic enzymes in order to obtain the functional insulin, which contains only the A chain and the B chain. Now, in insulin structure, there is A chain, B chain, which are connected together by disulfide bridges. Remember the A chain, and always the disulfide bridges are formed between the cysteine residues, and the A chain has a 21 amino acid and the B chain has a total of 30 amino acids. There's another way of producing insulin. You can separately express the gene for A chain and B chain in separate E. coli cells. So then you obtain the double-stranded DNA fragments. You take the DNA fragments only for A chain and B chain, introduce the DNA fragment of A chain in the PBR322 and B chain in PUC18. Adjacent again, you are going to splice it with the LACZ gene within the plasmid, within the expression site of this expression plasmid, and you are going to splice them together by using DNA ligase, and you are going to introduce or transform separate E. coli cells, one of the E. coli cells having the gene for A peptide of insulin, and the other E. coli cell having the gene for B peptide of insulin, and you are going to introduce them by making the E. coli cells competent by using the calcium chloride method. And then you are going to grow these transformed E. coli cells. One of the E. coli cells is going to produce the A chain and the other one is going to produce the B chain. So here you are going to separately produce A chain and separately produce B chain. Again, you are going to use the same method. The A chain and the beta galactosidase fusion protein is separated, and the B chain and the beta galactosidase fusion protein is separated using cyanogen bromide. You bring the A chain and the B chain together. You stimulate the formation of disulfide bridges between cysteine residues, and this is called as a disulfide activation. And then finally you obtain the A chain with the B chain connected together by the disulfide bridge, and this is what is referred to as the functional insulin molecule. So here you can see how in one of the E. coli cells you're using a different plasmid, which we mentioned as PBR322. Here you have introduced only the insulin A gene, and then you're using the gene for the insulin A chain. And in another separate E. coli cell, you have another plasmid, say PUC18, in which you are introducing the gene construct for insulin B peptide. So you're obtaining a fusion. See, this is the fusion protein. You have the insulin A chain along with the red chain. The red one represents the beta galactosidase. You separate them using cyanogen bromide, and then the red chains include the A chain and the B chain, as it is mentioned over here. The green molecule is the beta galactosidase. You're getting rid of the beta galactosidase by using cyanogen bromide, and you put together the A chain and the B chain, and you carry out disulfide bridge activation. You get functional insulin, which is commercially, then later after clinical trials and purification and all that, it is commercially distributed. Then we have gene therapy replacement of a faulty gene, and you all know the gene therapy was for the first time carried out on a 4-year-old girl who was suffering from a severe combined immunodeficiency because of a defective immune system, and it was led or pioneered by a group that was led by W.F. Anderson in 1990. In this procedure, only the lymphocytes, the small number of lymphocytes, are taken from the blood of the patient. They are cultured in vitro, and then you introduce the normal adenosine deaminase gene, which is not functional in this particular T lymphocytes. After that, you are introducing the gene by infecting these T lymphocytes by a disarmed retroviral vector. Following that, the gene gets incorporated into the T lymphocyte, and now the T lymphocyte has become genetically modified, and you are reintroducing these genetically modified T lymphocytes, which have the normal copy of adenosine deaminase in them, back into the patient's body. And then you can say this is not permanent, it has to be done repeatedly. But of course, if you incorporate the ADA gene into the embryonic cells, then it of course gets incorporated into each and every cell of the developing embryo, and it could be. So this is what is called as the embryonal gene therapy, the embryonal, as opposed to the somatic gene therapy, which is not a permanent cure. So like I was telling you, somatic cell line gene therapy is something that is done in somatic cells. It cannot be passed on from one person to the next generation because you are not involving the germinal cells here. But if you replace the defective gene in reproductive cells, say for example in the gamete or in the zygote itself or in the embryo itself, then it is referred to as the germline gene therapy, because it is something which can be passed on, and each and every cell in the body can get incorporated with that gene, and it can start expressing right at the early stage, and therefore it is a permanent cure. So application is not only to treat the diseases that we mentioned here, severe combined immunodeficiency diseases, but also to cure certain genetic inborn genetic diseases, congenital diseases, genetic diseases which are there from the time of birth, like for example cystic fibrosis. And then in the case of certain genetic disorders, like again you have muscular dystrophy, and illnesses such as hemophilia, rheumatoid arthritis are under trial. So basically a lot of trials are happening all over the world to check if that gene therapy is effective against all these genetic disorders. Molecular diagnosis, you can use biotechnology in order to detect certain diseases at an early stage. Like, for example, you can use recombinant DNA technology, you can use PCR, polymerase chain reaction, and ELISA, enzyme linked immunosorbent assay. In PCR, you know you are going to amplify the nucleic acid even if you have the smallest amount of DNA. Say, for example, in the blood sample of a person, once you isolate the DNA, it may have the DNA from the pathogen that is present in the blood, and it may be very, very less in concentration for you to detect it, and as a result you can subject the sample to the PCR, and once you obtain a large quantity of the pathogenic DNA, you can easily detect them using agarose gel electrophoresis and by using a suitable probe against a specific DNA sample that you want to detect. So probe, like I said, once you have amplified the DNA of the pathogen, you have the pathogen specific probe which will go and bind only specifically to the pathogenic DNA in the sample that you have just amplified. That indicates that yes, the person's blood had a pathogenic sample in it. That is because when you extracted the DNA from the patient's blood, you also ended up extracting the DNA from the pathogen which you have amplified using PCR. So applications is you can detect HIV, because one of the most important challenges of detecting HIV is it is not very easy to detect HIV in early stages, because the concentration, or you can say the titer value of the virus, the level of the virus and the level of the viral genome is very, very less in its concentration. So if you can amplify it using PCR, you can detect it at an early stage. It can also be used to detect mutation in cancer patients and to detect many other genetic disorders. ELISA is based on an antigen-antibody interaction, and here you can detect an infection. Like ELISA is used as a confirmatory test for HIV. That is, if a person is infected with HIV, he will carry antibodies against the HIV virus. You can detect the presence of antigens in this case, or in the example that I gave you, you can detect the presence of antibodies in the person's body by using this ELISA technique. The fact that he has antibodies against HIV antigen indicates that he has already been exposed to HIV and thus he is HIV positive. Then there are transgenic animals which carry foreign gene, which you can basically create using biotechnological procedures, and they are referred to as genetically modified organisms. You can alter the normal physiology and development by introducing abnormal genes. You can create models for human diseases, like I've mentioned here. The study of diseases can be carried out. You cannot study how the disease is progressing in humans. You cannot carry experiments on humans. So you can carry out experiments on animals by expressing human genes in them. Say, for example, rheumatoid arthritis or Alzheimer's disease, cancer, cystic fibrosis. You can carry it out in animals which are very close to or closely related to humans, like primates, and of course in mouse and in rats, etc. You can recreate those disease conditions in the animals by introducing the genes in those animals by using biotechnological or genetic engineering methods. You can also obtain biological products. You can use these animals as pharmacies, literally, because by introducing certain genes, let's say for example human genes, inside these animals you can obtain gene products. Like, for example, a human protein that is alpha antitrypsin was basically obtained from a plant, from another organism, from an animal. Like, for example, this alpha 1 antitrypsin is used to treat a disease that is referred to as emphysema. And like, see how a cow is producing a human protein, and this cow that was produced, that was created, or a transgenic cow that was created in 1997 by introducing the human gene, produced a human protein, the milk that was enriched with the human protein, and the name given to this cow was Rosie. So literally they become like factories which are producing important proteins because they carry a human gene in them. And then you can also see how the milk that was produced by Rosie was rich in alpha lactalbumin, which was nutritionally balanced product for human bodies, than the normal cow milk. You can also test vaccines in transgenic mice that were used to test the vaccines of polio vaccine, for example. You can also do certain chemical safety testing. You can test certain toxic chemicals on certain animal models before using them on human trials. Ethical issues is where you are manipulating. One of the things that comes into picture is where you are manipulating living organisms here. Like I told you, can use primates and mouse and rats. It is not advisable because you're using these living organisms. And it is something where you are playing God and you are playing nature. It is against the law of nature, and that is where the ethical issues comes into picture. Therefore, the Indian government has set up an organization that is called GEAC, Genetic Engineering Approval Committee, which will sit together and make decisions about whether or not it is advisable to alter the genetic makeup of organisms only to satisfy the human needs or the needs of human consumption. And basically, it validates any kind of GM research and it introduces certain safety regulations as to what can be done and what cannot be done and to what level we can manipulate the genome of a particular organism to suit the human needs. Okay, and what exactly is a patent? You're giving ownership right to the inventor. So supposedly a product which supposedly is invented by a person, he gets the right to he gets the rights of ownership, and any company before replicating it or before bringing it to the market must take permission by that particular owner. So there is a lot of disadvantages associated with it. Like for example, we have been growing basmati rice and rice for several centuries in our country. And in America, in 1997, there was an American company which illegally received patents for basmati rice because it created a new variety which had actually been derived from Indian varieties itself, and it claimed that the new variety of basmati that it had created was something that was created on its own home ground and something which was a product of its own ingenious research. But then ultimately it was derived from one of the Indian varieties, and so if this continues, several other companies can eye several other traditional medicinal or plants or animals which are basically grown in our own country. Like for example, you can say turmeric and neem, which have been used in our traditional herbal medicines for centuries. So somebody in some other country will grow a different variety of turmeric and neem, obtaining from our a cultivar from our own country, and will claim that they have invented a new variety of turmeric or neem, and therefore this is where biopatenting comes into picture. It should be very, very careful. Companies should be very, very careful and vigilant, making sure that countries do not steal the intellectual property of other countries or do not basically claim something which has already been grown for centuries together in another country as something that is created in their own home ground and something which is original to their land. Okay, so this is what is biopiracy, where multinational companies steal bioresources from other countries and claim to have generated it themselves, and therefore some of the people in other countries, they do not get their due recognition and they do not get their due compensatory payment must be provided for these people, because those are the ones who have been studying the wild varieties of plants and animals and have been using them in herbal medicine for centuries together through biodiversity and traditional knowledge. So one important thing is commercialization comes into picture here, how we are using traditional knowledge and we are commercializing it and we are using it for modern applications, and we are not providing proper compensation to the people who are in direct contact with nature and natural resources. Say for example, tribal people are being met with injustice in this case, and as a result, nations should develop new laws to prevent this kind of misuse of their bioresources and traditional knowledge. The Indian Parliament has recently cleared the Second Amendment of Indian Patents Bill that takes such issues into consideration, so that no injustice is meted out to such people who are actively involved in conserving the traditional biodiversity of our country. So now moving on to the next chapter, that is strategies for enhancement in food production. M.S. Swaminathan initiated collaboration with Dr. Norman Borlaug, and you all know M.S. Swaminathan is the father of Green Revolution in our country, and the father of Green Revolution in the whole world is Dr. Norman Borlaug, and he was the one who collaborated with Dr. Norman Borlaug, and he introduced certain Mexican wheat varieties in India, and he brought about a spurt in the growth of agricultural crops in our country, which is referred to as the Green Revolution. What are the different steps which are involved in developing new varieties of plant? If you take traditional plant breeding, firstly you will collect germplasm. Germplasm collection means you are collecting all possible varieties of plants and seeds. The wild varieties, the wild population is like a library of varieties. So you need to go, you need to explore the wild varieties of crops. You need to check which is your desirable trait, which is growing out there in the wild. You need to collect those plants. You need to preserve them. You need to collect the seeds and preserve them so that you have it for your future hybridization processes or hybridization experiments. Suppose you want to release a new variety, you would carry out plant breeding in a controlled setup. For that you need raw material, and those raw material and that raw material is represented by the germplasm collected by all the wild varieties. Say for example, you have lot of plants which are growing in the wild, which are very, very tolerant to say very high temperature, tolerant to excessive rainfall, tolerant to depleted minerals in the soil, tolerant to less water conditions, or tolerant to high salinity. So you go out in the wild, you explore the wild population and you collect these seeds, and that is the collection of germplasm. And then you select parents, you identify, you evaluate these seeds and you identify the plants with desirable combination of characters. Okay, this is the character I want and this plant has this character. Oh, I found another plant. I want this character also to be combined in the hybrid. So I'm going to designate one plant as the male parent and the other plant as the female parent. Like say for example, I have a plant which is growing very, very tall, producing lot of fruits. Yes, I want that character. I have a plant which is tolerating heat. Yes, I want that character. So I choose them as the parents and I bring together the characters together. Like for example, grain length in rice is variable. You have longer grains, intermediate grains and shorter grains in the wild varieties. You choose whichever you want from the wild variety and you designate it as a parent for your hybridization experiment. So then if you say, cross hybridization, now I told you, you have selected the parents, you have to now cross hybridize them. And once you hybridize them, you obviously, the hybridization procedure, you are doing it manually, you are not letting the plants reproduce or pollinate on their own, you are doing it under controlled condition. It takes a very long time. As stated earlier, the wheat variety HUW 468, it took 12 years. Usually it takes any time between 6 to 12 years to develop a new plant variety on an agricultural farm. It is on the field. It is not something that you're doing by sitting in the lab within the confines of the walls. It is something which you do on the field. It is a complete field work. It takes almost 12 years, like the example that is given here. You have to conduct a single cross or you have to conduct multiple crosses. You obtain different varieties, you standardize them, you grow them in different environments within the same country, within different areas of a state. You see the results obtained are uniform all throughout, and only then you commercialize the seeds, you give it to the farmers and you tell them that yes, this is something that we have developed and you can go ahead and grow them and reap its benefits. So hybridization is maybe carried out between, within the species, it may be between two different varieties, or it may be within the same variety, intravarietal, between two different varieties, intervarietal, or within the same species, intraspecific. Or it may be between two different species, interspecific, or between two different genera, intergeneric. Okay, and what is the procedure? Like we saw, we first select parents and then you carry out why should you carry out self-pollination? Because you want to create pure plants. Pure plants means pure breeding plants, means you want to generate homozygotes. Generally, when you generate homozygotes, there is no dilution of characters and there's uniformity in expression of characters. So you, for whatever trait you want to you're interested in the parent, you must try and create a self, you must try and create a homozygous line or a pure breeding line by repeatedly self-pollinating the plant for 6 to 7 generations. And then if you have a female plant which is bisexual, which is having bisexual flowers, you have to remove the anther by emasculation, you have to bag them, you have to drop or dust the pollen of your desired male parent plant onto the stigma of the female parent plant, and then you have to tag them. And like I said, you have to carry out artificial pollination, and then you have to select and you have to grow all the recombinant seeds that you obtained by successful cross-pollination. You have to select those recombinants which are expressing your desirable characters. You have to test them repeatedly, release them in different states, release them in different districts of the state, and then once they show uniform expression of the characters, you need to commercialize them. So examples of some improved varieties: for wheat it is Kalyan, Sona and Sonalika. For rice it is Jaya and Ratna. For sugarcane it is Saccharum, Barberry and Saccharum officinarum. And rapeseed mustard, that is Brassica, Spusa, Swernim. These are some of the improved varieties that have been obtained by plant hybridization. High yielding varieties like Lerma Rojo of wheat and Sonora 64 and Safed Lerma, Choti Lerma, Sharbati Sonora, Rice IR8, Taichung Native, Jaya and Ratna, Sugarcane, Saccharum Barberry, Saccharum officinarum and Millets. So all these are examples you need to learn. You can learn them from your manual. And if you keep inbreeding plants, sometimes inbreeding or mating of individuals within closely related individuals, within them if you repeatedly keep hybridizing, or if they keep repeatedly undergoing self-pollination, it is not a good idea. Basically because it leads to inbreeding depression. Okay, what is inbreeding depression? Gradually the plants will not reproduce properly, they will not produce enough amount of fruits and seeds, so there is a decline in their productivity, there is a decline in their fertility as time passes, and this is what is referred to as inbreeding depression. So loss of vigor. Vigor refers to the hardness of the character, the hardiness of the character, how strongly the character is expressed, that is completely lost in case of inbreeding depression. And sometimes during inbreeding depression, you will have to carry out some kind of an intervarietal or an interspecific cross in order to reintroduce certain different alleles or certain alleles from a new species or a new variety, and that will create a mixed population again, and that will increase the variety again, and that may help in overcoming inbreeding depression. Hybrid vigor is, or heterosis is, a condition where the hybrid is always superior. Why is the hybrid superior when compared to both the parents? Obviously because in hybrid both the parental characters have been combined. The father is superior, the mother is superior. Obviously the child will have the superiority of both the father and the mother. So both the superior traits of the parents are together in the hybrid, and therefore the hybrid is considered to be superior. It is called hybrid vigor or heterosis. Polyploidy, then usually you have plants which have more than two sets of chromosomes, and this is possible only when you disrupt the mitotic spindle during the time of anaphase, say for example by treating it with certain chemicals like colchicine or granosin, which basically can disrupt the mitotic spindle. So obviously when mitosis is happening and when you are disrupting the mitotic spindle, you will obviously end up with double the number of chromosomes in it, isn't it? So when you have double the number of chromosomes or more than diploid number of chromosomes that is seen in the case of an organism, then you say that that organism is not a haploid, it is not a diploid, it obviously has more than two sets of chromosomes, and that is what is referred to as polyploid. So you have triploid, tetraploid, pentaploid, hexaploid and even octaploid, and generally if you have polyploids with odd number of genomes like triploid, pentaploid, etc., there is no proper pairing of chromosomes or synapses that happens during cell division or during gamete formation. So the gametes that are formed are sterile, and therefore they do produce pollen and they do produce eggs, but they cannot take part in fertilization. So please remember, odd number polyploids are generally sterile and they are mostly propagated only through vegetative means. So generally they are usually exhibiting a gygas effect. A gygas effect is where usually a polyploid organism becomes gigantic in size, or it may express more of a certain protein or more of a certain biochemical, or it may, like I said, it may produce huge fruits and huge flowers, and it may grow to become huge plants, and that is what is referred to as the gygas effect. And polyploidy may be autopolyploidy, allopolyploidy or autoallopolyploidy. In autopolyploidy, the same set is represented multiple times, like A represents one set of chromosome, represented thrice, triploid represented four, four times, that is tetraploid, and this is done by doubling of the chromosomes. Like I told you, when the cell is dividing, the zygote is dividing, you treat the cell with chemicals like colchicin or granosan, and then the cell becomes, or the cell will come to possess two sets of chromosomes or double the set of chromosomes. So if you stop the mitotic division of a diploid cell, you will end up with an extra two set of chromosome. It becomes tetraploid. This is seen in maize, rice and gram, and they do exhibit a sufficient level of zygase effect. In case of allopolyploidy, you have two different sets which are represented in more than diploid number, like in the case of raphanobrassica, that is basically, and in the case of triticale. Okay, so Raphanus sativus, that is cap, that is radish, and brassica, that is radish, and the member of Brassicaceae family, that is the mustard family. When you cross them, you get a plant that is called Raphanobrassica, where two different species are contributing the sets of chromosomes. So it is referred to as an allopolyploid. The first man-made cereal, which was triticale, was also obtained by crossing the wheat, that is Triticum turgidum, and rye. See, two different species you are crossing here, and you are obtaining a plant which is having two sets from two different plants, and therefore it is an allopolyploid. It is mostly sterile, but then you double the chromosomes, you disrupt the mitotic spindle, you get an allopolyploid, which then becomes fertile. Autoallopolyploidy is, in this particular case, all of you look here, you have two different sets contributed by two different species, but one set is represented in more than a diploid state, so it is referred to as autoallopolyploid in the case of Helianthus tuberosus. And here you can see how the bread wheat originated. Triticum monococcum with 2N is equal to 14. See, two different species, Triticum monococcum, Aegilops peltoids, both of them gave rise to, both of them have 2N is equal to 7. So the gamete will have N is equal to 7. This will produce a gamete which is N is equal to 7. When N is equal to 7 and N is equal to 7 fuse together after pollination and fertilization, you get 2N is equal to 14, but you have it to be sterile. Because let me say this, N is equal to 7 set is represented by A, and this 7 chromosome set is represented by B. So now you have a zygote which has A and B together, 7 plus 7, 14, but A is from one species and B is from another species. So it is an allodiploid, which is sterile. Now you carry out doubling by treating. This zygote is treated with colchicine or granosan, and then you can say AB becomes AA. BB, that is, it comes to now possess 7 7 7 7 7, 4s are 28, that is 28 chromosome, and this plant is now a fertile plant, which is called Triticum durum. So Triticum durum now has AAABB with 4N is equal to 28, because it has four sets, two sets coming from Triticum monococcum by doubling and two sets coming from Aegilops peltoids. And now you can imagine, again you cross it with a different species, that is 2N is equal to 14. Now this will produce a gamete which is N is equal to 7 again, which will come with the gamete produced by this plant, which is 2N is equal to 14. See, the gamete is diploid. Surprising, no? Here the gamete is haploid and here the gamete is diploid. So the obviously you will get a sterile triploid. 14 plus 7 is equal to what? Triploid. So here you have A coming from Triticum durum, B coming from Triticum durum, and C, let me call this set as C. So A, B, C, which has now become a sterile triploid, and now you carry out doubling of chromosomes. So you get A, A, B, B, C, C, which is nothing but a 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7. So you get what is referred to as 42 chromosomes, and that is now a hexaploid, because you have six sets of chromosomes. And this hexaploid, how did the triploid become hexaploid? By chromosomal doubling, like I told you, by treating it with colchicine or granosan. And then when you get a hexaploid Triticum aestivum, this is what we use today, which is hexaploid. It is an allopolyploid. A came from Triticum monococcum, B came from Aegilops peltoids, and C came from Aegilops squarosa. It is a combination of three different species. Mutation breeding, chemical mutagens are usually used in mutation breeding, like sodium azide and ethyl methane sulfonate are basically employed. You want to induce mutation in the plant, and you want that mutation, if it is beneficial, to be used for the benefit of mankind. Say for example, when mutating a plant, you're making it resistant to dryness or resistant to less water in the soil, then it is good for you. Or you can use mutations like physical mutagens like gamma rays, ultraviolet rays, X-rays, etc. They were first produced by Müller in 1927 for mutation with using X-rays on Drosophila, and Stadler used it in the case of maize, and use of induced mutations have developed improved varieties, and these improved varieties are referred to as mutation breeding. So you can see some of the examples for mutation breeding here. Resistance to yellow mosaic virus in bhindi called Parbhani Kranti. High yielding Mexican wheat, Sharbati Sonora, Pusa Lerma, and resistant in mung bean to yellow mosaic virus and powdery mildew were induced by creating mutations using chemical and physical mutagens. Gamma ray treatment of Pelita rice line. So there was a rice line called Pelita 1 rice line in Indonesia, which was treated with gamma rays, and it has now produced a very high yielding variety called Atomita 2, which is resistant to a pest which is called as the brown plant hopper. Similarly, another plant variety called rice yielding variety called Remy has been obtained by using gamma irradiation. So you can see how physical irradiation can result in conversion of one variety to another, or a beneficial variety can be obtained by inducing mutations. Genetic variation present among plant cells by using tissue culture. Now we are using tissue culture to produce soma clonal variation. Some of the soma clonal variation. Now what exactly is genetic variation present among plant cells? When you are growing plant cells in a tissue culture, the cells may have variation among them. You pick those variations and you propagate them. You can obtain disease resistant plants. You can obtain stress tolerant plants. You can create plants which usually have male sterility. You can overcome male sterility by propagating the plants, and you can bring about early maturation and better yield and better quantity, etc., by picking variations in groups of plants, plant cells which you grow using tissue culture or micropropagation. So soma clonal variations have been produced in wheat tolerant to rust and high temperature, and then rice, which is basically tolerant to leaf ripper and tune grow virus, and potato, which is tolerant to late blight causing pathogen, which is a fungus called Phytophthora infestans, and several other examples for soma clonal variants. So you can also use genetic engineering to alter the genetic alteration, which is the alteration of the genetic makeup of an organism. You can transfer or replace certain genes to create recombinant DNA. You can introduce your desirable gene in the plant cell, and you can make the plant cell express the desirable gene. Like we had seen in biotechnology chapter, you are making the plant express certain genes which are from a bacteria called Bacillus thuringiensis, which is producing the toxin in its inactive form that is called the Bt toxin. Breeding of crops with higher levels of vitamins and minerals is called biofortification. And then if you grow certain microorganisms which are very, very rich in proteins which can be used as human food, microorganisms such as bacteria, yeast and filamentous algae, then it is referred to as single cell protein. The single cell protein can be produced from any microorganism like bacteria, algae and fungi, mostly in the case of yeast. And you can use a lot of raw material for that. Like for example, if you want an algae to produce organic substances, the raw material will obviously be carbon dioxide. Or if you can use certain industrial effluents, like after extracting the curd or after extracting the water that is left behind after the curdling of milk, which is called whey, which is very rich in protein. Or you can also use certain low-cost organic material to feed these microorganisms like sawdust and paddy straw, etc. Generally, after the single cell protein is obtained from these unicellular microorganisms or sometimes even multicellular forms like mushroom, etc., you will remove all unwanted biomolecules such as excess of nucleic acids. So you want to retain only the high quality protein in this particular SCP. It should also be poor in fats because it should be used as a routine nutritional supplement. And then you have microorganisms, which usually, like I said, the microorganisms which can produce enormous amounts of protein, which can be used as dietary supplements for humans, include algae, filamentous fungi, yeast, and bacteria that are routinely used in this case. Single cell protein are of great nutritional value because they contain a lot of protein, they contain a lot of vitamins and sometimes even fat content also, but they mostly are rich in essential amino acids and they are ideal supplements because most of the conventional supplements of food that we consume or most of the food products that we consume, they may usually lack some of the essential amino acids. So it is a perfect supplement for essential amino acids. A lot of research is going on in CFTRI of Mysore in use of blue-green algae, that is spirulina, as a supplement to diet, both for food in humans and both as a feed for animals. And this algae is cultured, it is dried and powdered, and it is sold in the form of tablets, and it contains almost 60% protein. So you can imagine the level of protein that is produced by this unicellular, this particular blue-green algae. Some of the common microbes used are cyanobacteria or blue-green algae, bacteria like Methylophilus methylotrophus, yeast like Candida utilis, and filamentous fungi like Fusarium graminearum. Okay? Yeast fermentation, you can also use yeast for obtaining certain fermentation products like alcohol and acetic acid from sugar residues that is used as a raw material. It was first obviously employed by Louis Pasteur, and he was the one who emphasized upon the importance of an enzyme called the zymase enzyme complex, which is a sucrase enzyme, which basically breaks down the sugar component and releasing the substrates like glucose, which can be used as a raw material for alcoholic fermentation. A number of organic acids like lactic acid, citric acid, and acetic acid are also extracted. You will be learning this in the chapter Microbes in Human Welfare. You have learnt it rather. Lactic acid fermentation, in order to obtain lactic acid, which is very, very routinely employed in curdling of milk. Now your milk is curdled because of production of lactic acid, which brings about the curdling of the milk protein, that is casein, isn't it? Which is nothing but the curd, and that is used routinely in your day-to-day life, and that lactic acid fermentation is employed or carried out by various bacteria like Lactobacillus delbrueckii, Streptococcus, Leuconostoc, and even in fungi such as Rhizopus. It was the first organic product, so very important, lactic acid was the first organic acid that was produced by microbial fermentation. Citric acid producing bacteria include Aspergillus niger and Mucor, and also they can be used for commercial production of high yield of citric acid, and certain yeast species like Candida lipolytica can also be used for industrial production of citric acid. Acetic acid is prepared from fermented alcohol with the help of acetic acid bacteria. The acetic acid bacteria is Acetobacter acetae, and conversion of alcohol to acetic acid is an aerobic process where you obtain about 10 to 13% of acetic acid, after which the liquid is obtained, and it is used after ripening. It is used as something which is referred to as vinegar. Fuels for biomass energy sources. Now you can also, biomass is something which is a traditional fuel which is obtained in products like mostly which are obtained from products of biological origin, like for example coal, biogas, oil, all these are obtained by compression of biological or partially degraded biodegradable organic matter in the earth's crust is what gives rise to coal and peat and wood and even oil, etc. And you use dried animal dung in order to obtain biogas or gobar gas, which contains 54 to 70% of methane. A group of bacteria called methanogens, you all are aware that methanogens are the ones which are involved in biogas production, that is methanobacteria. These are archaebacteria that can survive in very hostile environments, and you also saw how we produced ethanol through fermentation, and it has been produced from the sugar that is extracted from sugarcane plants. So sucrose that is extracted from the juice. So basically the sugar that is extracted from the sugarcane plant, and it leaves behind a syrup which is called as the molasses or the mother liquor, which contains a lot of glucose and fructose, and it is fermented by the yeast which is called Saccharomyces cerevisiae in order to obtain alcohol. And now there is employment of alcohol in order to run vehicles in the form of gasohol, that is mixture of alcohol and gasohol, that is petrol. Plant tissue culture. Gottlieb Haberland was the first one to employ or attempt plant tissue culture to cultivate mechanically isolated plant leaf cells on a very simple nutrient medium. So the hormones that are employed in plant tissue culture, which is routinely also called as micropropagation, some of the hormones include auxins and cytokinins. Auxins are used as rooting hormones. They are capable of production of adventitious roots from stem cuttings or from explants. And cytokinins are used as a shooting hormone. If the ratio of auxin to cytokinin is higher, it causes rooting. If the ratio is lower, it causes shooting. And then you saw that there is gibberellins, which are employed here, gibberellic acid. It helps in breaking the dormancy of buds, which can be cultured using tissue culture. And then it is used also abscisic acid and polyamines are also employed, which act as nutrients to plant cells, which you are growing in vitro on a culture dish or a petri dish. So there is three important things. First one, you need a suitable nutrient medium. You need completely uncontaminated or aseptic conditions so that instead of the plant that is growing on the agar medium, you should not have a bacteria or a fungus growing there. So you have to maintain strict aseptic conditions. You have to ensure that the plant tissue that is growing is supplied with adequate oxygen supply so that it grows well. The most extensively used nutrient medium is MS, that is Murashige and Skoog medium, in 1962 that was developed, and it is treated with a gelling agent which is referred to as agar-agar, extracted from the seaweeds, and this usually on boiling it and mixing it with agar and then later allowing it to cool down, it solidifies itself, and it can later be, when it is still in a liquid form, it can be plated onto certain culture dishes, or it can be used to make slants in the test tube and then it can be allowed to cool. It acts as a suitable nutrient medium on which the plant tissue cells can grow. So you have to maintain aseptic conditions, and these aseptic conditions are used for in vitro culturing. You have to ensure proper aeration so that constantly the medium which contains plant cells are stirred by using an automatic shaker, so that there is enough oxygen that dissolves in the nutrient medium, because the plant cells need to grow, and for them to grow normally they need to undergo aerobic respiration. There should be sufficient supply of oxygen. The plant material that is grown in vitro forms, either you can grow it in the form of callus culture, or you can grow it on a liquid medium that is called suspension culture. The type of explant, whatever you choose to grow in the tissue culture, the part of the plant that you choose to grow is referred to as the explant. It may be a single cell, it may be a shoot, a part of the root, it may be a somatic embryo, that is a cell which is grown in vitro, may take shape of an embryo, it may form a mass of cells which will soon take shape into a shoot tip and a root tip, and this is called a somatic embryo because it is obtained from a regular cell of the plant that is being grown in the culture condition. It can be a culture obtained from meristem. It can be a culture that is obtained from the anther, which is a haploid production, because anther contains haploid cells which are called microspores, which may be employed to obtain sterile haploid plants. Sometimes you strip the cell wall of the plant cells to obtain the protoplast, and you can fuse the protoplast by a procedure that is called somatic hybridization. You can also culture embryos in vitro. You can culture ovules again to obtain haploid, and you can culture ovaries. Say if you culture ovaries, you may obtain fruits which are of larger size than the ovary that will develop into a fruit when it is still attached to the plant. So if it is callus culture, like I said, callus culture is mostly done on a solid medium. But if it is a suspension culture, the plant cells are suspended on a suitable liquid medium. And so the liquid culture which contains the suspended plant cells is what is referred to as the suspension culture. Suspension cultures are constantly agitated by using automatic shakers, which can constantly move this culture or ensure that it is continuously moved at a rate of about 100 to 250 revolution per minute, and they grow faster than callus culture. The individual cells are in constant exposure to the nutrient enriched media, the liquid medium outside. They can quickly absorb nutrients from the outside medium, and they grow much faster in comparison to the callus culture. Subculturing is where you have obtained a callus culture or you have obtained a group of cells and the cell density has increased too much and you transfer some of the cells to a fresh media so that you can maintain the population of cells, because if you have a medium where too many cells are growing, then they will start competing with each other for nutrients and the cell may start growing. So you need to subculture it after a certain stage. Single cell culture, you either take it from a liquid culture where you can where you're culturing one particular cell is picked up from a suspension in a liquid medium and it is transferred onto a agar plate, that is basically where it is grown on a liquid agar medium. So basically you can see how the cells are mixed with the single cells are mixed with the liquid agar medium and they are spread out on a petri dish and they grow over there. So this is called the Bergman's plating technique. And here what you do is you take single cells. It is a suspension that is made up of single cells, okay? Or you can grow the single cell. You can take one single cell and grow it on a piece of filter paper that is called a filter paper raft that is placed on the callus. It derives its nutrition from the callus and then it starts growing into a callus of its own. And after it grows into a lump of cells, you can separate it from the filter paper and you can grow them in a separate colony. See, the colonies are isolated. They are either cultured again in a callus culture or in the form of suspension culture. Like I said, shoot culture, the shooting hormone is cytokinin, like benzene, amino, purine. Remember, cytokinins do not naturally occur in the plants, of course. Cytokinins are mostly found in plant extracts, like for example, zeaxanthin, which is obtained in corn kernels. And root culture, like I said, is extracted or promoted by spraying or by treating the culture medium or the plant culture with auxin. Somatic embryos are embryos that develop from individual somatic cells. Sometimes each cell in the plant is totipotent because it is capable of developing into an entire plant. In the culture, what happens is the cell takes forms a callus and it develops into a plumule and a radicle, a small shoot and a root start developing. That means it has taken the shape of an embryo and that means it came from a normal cell in the plant and that's why it is called a somatic embryo. Then you have to say that once you have obtained the plantlets which are obtained on tissue culture are removed and they are established on the field, but not directly to the field. They are slowly put in sterile soil, slowly exposed to small durations of sunlight, and this is referred to as hardening. They are kept under reduced light and high humidity in nurseries, and once they get used to the natural conditions, they can be planted on natural soil. Culturing of the triploid plants: by culturing the triploid tissue of triple fusion or post-fertilization tissue, that is referred to as endosperm culture. Meristematic culture is where you take the apical or the axillary meristem and you culture them, and they are cultured on a medium containing cytokinin, because cytokinin is the one that is causing rapid division or multiplication of the meristematic cells, and that gives rise to a mass of cells called callus which takes shape as a plantlet. So meristematic culture has been carried out in potato, banana, cardamom and orchids, sugarcane, strawberry, sweet potato, etc. You can produce virus-free plants because meristems are actively dividing and they are devoid of viruses, because viruses cannot keep pace of the division of meristems. You can also conserve the germplasm of that particular plant. If you have a plant expressing beneficial characters, you can preserve the cells of the plant in the form of meristem cultures and you can maintain a continuous line. And you can also produce transgenic plants by modifying the genetic material of the meristematic cells, and you can also obtain rapid clonal multiplication. You can prepare multiple clones of the plant, multiple plants obtained from the meristematic tissue of a particular plant expressing your desirable characters. If you want a haploid plant, then you either you can obtain it from an unfertilized egg cell, or if you want a very easy method, you can obtain it from the culture of anthers, which contains these haploid cells which are referred to as microspores. And when you culture the anther tissue, it is referred to as anther culture, mostly to obtain microspores. This technique was developed by Guha and Maheshwari in 1964 and cultured matured anthers of Datura inoxia. Okay, so it was first used in India to produce haploid cultures of this plant called Datura. Embryo cultures are where you can obtain young embryos from developing seeds. You can culture them, young embryos, on a nutrient media, and you can allow them to grow into bigger plantlets. And then you can use embryo culture in plants, like for example, in case of orchids. Okay. Or if you have a sterile seed, a seed which when you sow will not give you a plant, you can obtain these plantlets by using tissue culture. You can culture these embryos in the seed and you can obtain the plants and you can micropropagate them and grow them in the wild, isn't it? So embryo culture can also escape, you can overcome the seed dormancy of the plants by using this embryo culture in this particular case. You can also prepare haploids by elimination of chromosome. Surprisingly, when you cross wheat or barley with a plant called Hordeum bulbosum, it results in complete elimination of one set of chromosomes in order to obtain haploid wheat or barley plants. So basically, there are many micronuclei that are formed with the segments of chromosomes in them. So they get eliminated naturally in the plant. One complete set gets eliminated to produce haploid plants. Ovule culture is for raising hybrids which normally fail to develop. So you have a hybrid fruit and the hybrid seed is not developing, but you want to grow it in the lab. So you can culture the ovule which is obtained from a hybrid so that you can prevent the abortion of the embryo, or you can still obtain an embryo by plant tissue culture, which is a hybrid embryo. Ovary culture is where you culture the ovary of sexually incompatible species like Brassica campestris and Brassica oleracea. Now generally what happens here is you are culturing these ovules, sorry, the ovary in a medium that promotes formation of fruits. So you are culturing ovary in order to obtain a fruit that is much larger than what you would get when the ovary is attached to the plant body. In anatom, addition of kinetin in the medium cause polyembryony to give rise to multiple shoots. So when you planted the ovary in an artificial medium in case of a plant called anatom and you treated it with kinetin, surprisingly the seed started developing more than one embryo in them and you obtain more than one plantlet, and that is called polyembryony. Micropropagation is a tissue culture technique. So that's what we were discussing all this while, where from a single explant you get hundreds of plants. All of them are clones of each other and they're referred to as soma clones. And sometimes, yeah, because you have these plant cells which are obtained from a single explant, all of them are clones of that explant and therefore they are called soma clones. This micropropagation where you obtain soma clone is also referred to as soma clonal propagation. It has been used in several plants like lily, orchids, eucalyptus, cinchona, blueberry, etc. and lot of fruit trees also. So there are four steps. You initiate the culture, you grow, you take a suitable explant, you allow shoot formation, you allow root formation, you obtain plantlets and you harden them and transplant them to the natural environment. Protoplast is somatic hybridization. You obtain the protoplast, you strip the plant cell of its cell wall, you have only the protoplast with you, and this is known as the somatic and you take two protoplasts from two different plants and fuse them, you obtain what is referred to as somatic hybrid. This is called as somatic hybridization. How do you fuse the protoplast of two plant cells which usually have been stripped off their cell wall? Is by using these chemicals called polyethylene glycol or sodium nitrate. Sometimes when you use chemicals, it is referred to as chemofusion. Sometimes you can fuse the protoplast by using high voltage electric pulse. It is called electric fusion. So once you fuse the two protoplasts, ultimately they will give rise to a hybrid cell, which is now referred to as the somatic hybrid. And this somatic hybrid may be grown in a tissue culture in order to obtain the somatic hybrid plant. The first ones obtained were in the species of tobacco, where two plants were combined using somatic hybridization, Nicotiana glauca and Nicotiana langstorfit, by Carlson et al. In the year 1972. Successful somatic hybridization has also been carried out in Brassica, in Petunia, in Solanum, and like for example, a somatic hybrid of potato and tomato by fusing a protoplast of potato with the protoplast of tomato to obtain a plant called pomato, and also bomato in order to as a fusion product of the protoplast obtained from brinjal plant and tomato plant. If you have somatic embryos, sometimes you can encapsulate these somatic embryos that take shape from normal plant cells growing in tissue culture, which are called somatic embryos. They are not germinal cells, they are normal plant cells. Say you've taken a leaf cell, you've taken a leaf tissue and you're growing it in the plant tissue culture. One of the leaf cells which are formed in the plant tissue culture may start taking shape of an embryo. You take these embryos and you encapsulate them in an artificial matrix that is composed of sodium alginate along with substances like mycorrhizae, herbicides and fungicides, and then you can sow them in the soil and these can act as artificial seeds. So an artificial seed can be either prepared in two ways, that is, one is a desiccated system and one is a hydrated system. In desiccated system, you make the embryo hardened enough to overcome desiccated condition or to withstand desiccated condition. In hydrated system, you usually ensure that the seeds are always maintained under proper hydrated conditions or water conditions, and you can see how the hydrated system, the beads that are produced by sodium alginate, they become hardened by using calcium alginate, because here you're using calcium alginate, so they actually become hard like seeds, and after about 20 to 30 minutes they are removed and they are washed with water and they're used in case of planting. Okay, hydrated artificial seeds become dry rapidly to open air. So if you expose them to open air, they become very, very dry rapidly, and they have been used to plant. They have to be planted very soon or immediately as soon as they are produced. This technique in India is being carried out in Mulberry in Baba Atomic Research Center of Mumbai. So this kind of artificial seed technique is carried out in case of both sandalwood and in case of mulberry. Okay. So with this, we complete the synopsis for two chapters, biotechnology applications and strategies for enhancement in food production. Thank you.